Hey guys, it's Rick Ginn. I'm going to walk you through the basics of doing your first subject to deal. And I'm going to share you the simplicity of how to use this strategy in your current wholesaling business. But before I get into it, do me a favor, make sure you smash that like button, hit that subscribe button so we can continue to deliver you the truth on wholesaling. So the buying and selling of property without a bank freaks out a lot of people. Now, if you're a seasoned wholesaler or even a brand new wholesaler, just to let you know, there's plenty of real estate that goes down without having a bank involved. Now, a subject who actually has an existing bank involved, where you simply take over the existing terms of the mortgage just like you were the original buyer, and that's what they call a subject to. It is called subject to. Anything else is a slang word, and it is not recognized outside of wholesaler language. So don't use short abbreviated terms because you're going to look foolish in front of lawyers, title companies, and other real estate investors. It's called subject to. Call it what it is. The term's been around for hundreds of years, guys. This is not new. It's not been recently invented. In fact, I'm here to tell you, you can make a lot of money doing this, but you've got to understand how to use the language first. Number two, I feel the responsibility when it comes to subject to, that it is a technique used in creative financing, mostly by wholesalers, and it's not to be taken lightly. You see, when you take over someone's existing debt, you have a responsibility. And I don't believe in constantly assigning these types of deals, taking your money and walking away. In fact, it makes you more liable. There are people that take over subject twos and never make a payment. And I do not teach that method. I do not endorse it. And for that reason, make sure you know what you're getting into with the subject two, which I'm going to share some of the trainings on this today. Make sure you work with your title company and you understand the mechanics of it. And more importantly, make sure you involve some sort of real estate attorney to help you draw up the correct paperwork. Because if you've never done this before, this is not the time to learn this while you're doing on-the-job training. So subject to is available to everybody. Most people do it as they gain experience when they get active in real estate investing. Now, I'm going to show you how you can locate and find your subject to deals in your existing wholesaling business without doing some crazy strategy where you only want to do subject twos, because I believe wholesaling is still the greatest skill, but occasionally you're going to find some creative financing like subject twos within your wholesaling business. And I'm going to show you how to identify them and actually how to take advantage of them, even if you don't have experience. So now that we know that we need to get help when we do them and we need to make sure we're completely legal and most importantly, responsible to it. Most subject to deals I train people to do is you take the deal on yourself and you are 100% responsible. So keep that in mind. The next thing I want you to understand is you can't chase people in subject twos. It doesn't exist. In fact, I'm here to tell you, if your sole mission is to market to people just in subject two, probably shut this video off, because I don't believe people should just go out and seek subject two deals only. There are advantages and disadvantages, which we're going to go over today, but you can't go out and go, I'm just going to market to anyone that would be a potential subject to. How would you do that? You just look for people with low equity that have recently bought. Please don't do it, because I just don't think it's right. I'm sorry. I think you should incorporate it in your wholesaling business. And unless you have a ton of experience and you know how to talk to people and you know how to negotiate and you have all the correct paperwork, I know what you're going to say. I took a course and they taught me all of it. Unfortunately, the laws are changing so rapidly. And these mass production of courses, it's not going to cover your butt. And remember, you're the one that has to sign and put your name on everything. You are going to be responsible if that mortgage goes unpaid. And the only way to prevent that is make sure you're always in control. So the first rule is you should incorporate this strategy within your own wholesaling business. Now, I don't go out and teach you how to find subject two specifically. That's a wild goose chase. And that's where everybody's getting in trouble. Because there's so many variables that go into a subject two that if you just chase those, you're going to get lost. How do I know this? Because I have people in my own groups, their only job is someone taught them to chase subject two deals. And they're so desperate to do the deals, they just want to ink them. A lot of people that do subject two deals, You can't even tell if they made any money. Just doing a contract doesn't mean you made money. How do you know? You got to know your area, you got to know prices, and you've got to know the laws on how to govern a subject to, and you got to know where the profit is in it. Is it up front? Is it in the middle? Is it the end? I teach you how to do it in all three sectors, but there's a lot of courses out there that just want you to get into subject to, so you don't have to go out and get bank financing. So let's find ways that we can actually incorporate it in your wholesaling business. Every now and then you're going to get a deal that comes across your desk. Most of the time we're looking for people with high equity that want to sell quickly, and that's our target. And that's where you make your bread and butter, guys. As you season along and move on, if you find a subject to deal, then you can take action. But going out and hunting subject to solely, there's so many people chasing them, you're going to get bit up. And actually, the same problem that the creative financing teachers have taught you, like why do wholesaling, there's so much competition? They've shoved everybody over in the creative financing, and kind of the opposite's happening now. So the reason I like wholesaling, it's not easy, but it's not hard, but it makes a ton of money and nobody can ever deny that. So I want you to make cash. And if subject to deal comes up and you want to take advantage of it, you have the funds, you have the skill sets and the ability to move forward. You didn't change your whole operation just for subject twos. So a typical subject two that comes up in your wholesaling business is just not enough equity in it, or they bought it with a very low down payment. Maybe it was a government loan. They did 2 to 3%. Some are like zero down. I don't know if they even do that anymore. And they got to get relocated for some reason, or somebody lost their job, or say someone's leaving the country. And then basically when you go to see them and visit them, or if you're doing it over the phone, you have to be the only solution for a subject too. Let me repeat this. You have to be their only solution for a subject two to work, period. You don't convince people to do a subject two. So how do I do it? I walk them through it. Number one, have you thought about listing with a realtor? Yeah, but the realtor told me I have to write a $30,000 check to make it work with closing costs and realtor fees. Okay, have you thought about renting it? Yeah, but the house is gonna get trashed and we're gonna be on the other side of the country and I don't wanna deal with it. Number three, have you just thought about giving it back to the bank? The bank doesn't really want it and we don't want a foreclosure on the record. We've worked too hard. I'd rather find a way to solve this problem. And the last one, I go, you ever thought about just walking away from the property? Why? Because I want them to walk through every exit strategy to know the subject two is the only one. If it is the only one, the deal will work well if they want to cooperate. If any of those other three or four that I mentioned right there will solve their problem and they want to do that, you'd rather find out now then later and do all this paperwork, or actually do the paperwork and have them change their mind, because it's going to be problematic. So at this point, they might wait a week or two and call you back and go, you know what, Rick, we thought about it. You are the only solution. Now, the advantage is, why would they do a subject two with a wholesaler? It's simple. Number one, you save their credit. Number two, you prevent a foreclosure going on their record. Number three, they don't have to write a big fat giant check out of their pocket. And you're basically saving them sometimes $20,000, $30,000, or $50,000. And the next one is you eliminate their stress problem and you actually give them a solution. Think about it. If you were in that situation, what are your options? Doing a subject to deal is usually the best answer. Now, you're never going to make somebody do it. And here's the next rule. If they're not 100%, I mean 100% on board, don't do it, because you're going to need their cooperation with paperwork, insurance, and additional documents from the bank every now and then, escrow and stuff like that. So if they're gonna fight you up front, it'll be 10 times worse in the middle and the back end. So I make them come to me and basically not beg me, but like, please, will you help us out with this? Now, when you get that strategy, you're gonna get a great deal and you're gonna get great terms. Go over to freewholesaling.com. We have an entire section dedicated to this. But remember, you need great terms. You need an indefinite amount of period to cash their mortgage out. I don't do 3-year restrictions. The minimum I do is 60 months, but most of the time I leave it open for the rest of the mortgage. So if somebody just bought a house, they had a 30-year mortgage and they're in year two, they got to give me 28 years to rectify the situation. Why? Because I have no idea what's going to happen with the market, what's going to happen with the property when I do it. And I want as much time as humanly possible. I can always shorten it. I can never lengthen it. So keep that in mind when dealing with a subject two. The next rule on a subject two, especially for a beginner, is the property has to be in very good shape. Why? Because if the property's run down, or say it needs a massive $50,000 rehab, someone's got to come up with the money. It's not going to be you. It's obviously not going to be the seller. And it gets very complicated and very advanced strategies. And this is not where you want to be. Most of the time when a property's run down and it's in really bad shape, the property just needs to be sold. If it needs to be foreclosed on, short sold, or wholesaled, the numbers will dictate that. But the reality is, usually when the property is run down, this creates another monster, which means the property is typically in some sort of stage of foreclosure, pre-foreclosure, and they're usually behind between 6 and 18 months in payment, and you're never going to be able to make that up. Remember, we want clean properties ready to rent or do a creative financing to sell to an end user that maybe has bad credit, but they have a ton of money in cash flow. And when we give our seller, we give them a small amount of money up front. I don't give $20,000 and $30,000 for a commercial deal, maybe, but on my typical deal is anywhere from $500 to $5,000. That's it. I'm not doing any more because I want 10% down on the house when I turn around and sell it. So no heavy rehabs. And once they're behind 4 to 6 months, it becomes very difficult because the property is usually in foreclosure at this stage. You're going to have attorney's fees. And between the rehab and the makeup, sometimes you got to come up $60,000, $70,000. And I don't like deals like that. I need to churn them quickly and get them generating cash today. The only way you can do that was clean properties that aren't too far behind on mortgage payments. So I'm just going to walk you through the basics of how a subject to deal is going to work. As I said, go over to freewholesaling.com. We teach you more of the mechanics on it. So the first part is, if I give a low payment to induce the seller to give me the deed over, it usually takes something because it makes them feel better. And remember, I need their cooperation. I don't offer 20, 30 grand. Remember, if they don't use me, they got to write a check for 20 to 30 grand. So I'm already saving them a ton of money and headache up front. So usually I'll offer, as I said, I usually start around 1,000. I used to do these around 500. And I'll go up to the highest 5,000, depending on the area and the demand for that property. And if it's in great, ready move-in shape, that's dynamite. A lot of times I'm doing $1,000 to say $3,000, and I'm changing out usually like some carpet or changing appliances. And you have to add that all in the equation. I want you to be net under 5 or 6K when you do the deal. Number two, it's got to be ready for someone like you to live in, or it's got to be ready to rent tomorrow. You're going to have options what you're going to do with it. And that's the beauty of it. So the idea is, say if I'm doing 3K up front, and it's ready to go, and I got 30 days to find an end user. You're like, oh my God, how am I gonna do that? It's super simple, super simple. You're gonna offer owner financing on the deal, and basically they put down between 10 and 12%. So say the property was worth $300,000, you gave $3,000 up front, and you're like thinking, Rick, I don't have $3,000. I'm not asking to give you $3,000 of your money. You're gonna take $3,000 of your end buyer's money. So if somebody comes along, say it's $300,000, they give you, say, just 10%. That's $30,000. You pay $3,000 to your end seller. You might have to make one mortgage payment. So maybe you're into it for five, and that gives you a $25,000 profit up front. That's what we call the upfront cash flow. It's just like getting an assignment fee. Number two, you need to make those monthly payments. My recommendation is work with your title company or an outside escrow agent to make sure those payments are made on time. You can also have an agreement with the seller, whereas you can make the payments directly either to the seller or you can make them directly to the bank, and you can use an online portal for complete transparency on that. So in the perfect idea is there should be a cash flow spread. So if I'm getting a big chunk of money up front and say I'm paying a $1,500 mortgage, ideally I like to get $2,000 in a monthly payment, but it's give and take in all of it. Make sure the payment, you're incorporating taxes and insurance in it. That's called PITI, principal, interest, tax, and insurance. The next phase is say there's 27 years left on the mortgage. I don't want 27 years. So you got cash up front, you get cash in the middle, and then whatever the sale price is, I said it's worth $300,000, you should market usually anywhere from 10 to 12% higher. So if you're selling it for $330,000, keep in mind when that mortgage gets paid down, and say they want to cash you out in 3 years, you give them incentive to cash you out. You can give them credits toward it. I don't like to make it complicated, but you could potentially walk away with another $30,000 to $40,000 at the end. So you just took a deal. There's $40K at the end. Say there's a couple hundred by the time you net out the numbers in the middle. I'm not even going to include that number. And then the $25K up front, you're looking around $70,000 to $75,000 because you went through the entire transaction. Guys, I want you to do subject twos that fall in your lap, that they have no other option. I just want you to get help with the proper paperwork and understand the laws that govern this type of business in your state and the federal government, and make sure you are in compliance. And remember, make sure your sellers are 100% cooperative. The slightest bit of resistance can destroy these deals quickly. Now, my final tip on this, if you're a beginner wholesaler, the best place to incorporate subject to deals in your wholesaling business is go for the probates. Why? Think about this. On a probate, somebody's passed away. The biggest objection for someone taking over the subject to is, what happens if you don't make a payment or something doesn't go correctly? Remember, the loans in the deceased person, it eliminates this risk. They can only go after the person the loan's in. So if somebody does a subject to for a probate, they usually get cashed out quicker and they are eliminating any type of risk. It works out wonderfully. If you want, as a beginner, to target and get more subject to deals within your wholesaling business, look no further than probates. They are wonderful, they work well, and that's where I get most of my subject to deals. And don't worry about it, we give you a complete training over at freewholesaling.com. Go over there and check it out. And guys, let me know if you got value from this video. Let me know in the comments if you're using probates to do your first subject to deals. And as usual, if you got value from this video, do me a favor, make sure you smash that like button, hit that subscribe button, so we can continue to deliver the truth on wholesaling. This is Rick Ginn. I'll see you in the next video.